This is the day that the Lord has made. We shall rejoice and be glad in it. Welcome to Trinity United Church of Christ. We are so excited that you have joined us as we have curated a powerful worship service just for you on this, the Lord's Day. So come on, let's get ready to worship.
I got my walk clothes. today? Do you have joy in your heart, joy in your mind, joy in your spirit? Then why don't you make a joyful noise unto the Lord, all ye lands? Come on and serve God with gladness. Come before God's presence with singing. Know ye that the Lord is God. It is God that have made us, and not we ourselves. We are God's people and the sheep of God's pasture. So we ought to enter into his gates with thanksgiving and into his courts with praise and be thankful unto God and bless God's holy name. For God is good all the time, and all the time God is good. God's mercy is everlasting and God's truth endures to every generation. People of God, put your hands together and give our God some true, genuine praise. Let us pray the prayer that Jesus taught his disciples when they asked him, Master, teach us how to pray. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
I will bless the Lord at all times. God's praise shall continually be in my mouth. This is the season where we celebrate holiness squeezing into humanity in the form of a small baby named Jesus. This is the Advent season, the Christmastide, the Christmas time. And I'm delighted to be back at Trinity during this time period where we celebrate and make way for the King. I want to take a moment and say thank you. Thank you to the greatest church this side of the Jordan, Trinity United Church of Christ. Thank you for giving me a sabbatical, time to renew, to regenerate and reinvigorate my spirit, to spend time with my family, to spend time in prayer, to spend time contemplating what we are going to be doing in the future as God continues to take us higher and higher. On behalf of the Moss Tribe, we say thank you to the wonderful, amazing, incredible people of Trinity United Church of Christ. Many churches do not have this type of connectivity, where they recognize the need for sabbatical, even though we worship on a Sunday Sabbath. Jesus takes time off to spend time with the Father. Even in the early church, where the desert fathers and mothers retreated into the desert to contemplate their relationship with God. I thank the forward-thinking, creative, incredible, powerful people of Trinity United Church of Christ for giving me this time and giving my family this time. We say thank you, and we look forward to what God is about to reveal to us in the future. 2020 was difficult, but I tell you this, something is on the horizon where God is going to be using us in a powerful way in 2021. But right now, let's make way for the King. Celebrate Jesus. Remember that this is not our birthday, but we celebrate the birth of our Savior. May God bless you, and may God keep you.
Waiting for thee, my King.
Everything. God is my everything. God is my joy and sorrow, my hope for tomorrow, a rock in a weary land. God's people, God is my everything. Is that somebody's testimony watching or listening today, that God is your everything? Come on, let's give God some praise wherever you are for being your everything. We thank and praise God for the ministry of music of our sanctuary choir. Thank you for blessing us on this day. I just have a few announcements for you. Today at 4 o'clock p.m., we will have our first virtual Amani service of remembrance. Again, on today, December the 13th at 4 o'clock, we will take the time to remember and to celebrate the lives and the legacies of those persons who have transitioned through the veil of time in the year of 2020. And so if you have lost someone or just simply desire to be encouraged and have your hope restored, we invite you to watch at 4 o'clock p.m. today our Amani Service of Remembrance. Also on December the 23rd, we will have our first virtual Christmas concert. All of our choirs, all of our liturgical ministries will be participating in this service. They have been working very hard to make sure that we have some wonderful music and particularly a Christmas concert during this season and during this pandemic. So make sure that you mark your calendars for December 23rd at 7 o'clock. We promise that you will be blessed. Also this year, we will have 7 days in which we take the time to acknowledge the season of Kwanzaa. Each day, our pastoral team will share one of the principles of Kwanzaa. We ask that you would simply just mark your calendars beginning December the 26th and save the date so that you might not miss these powerful moments in which we educate and we share information about Kwanzaa. Finally, we just want to make sure that you continue to remain safe. As you know, this pandemic is very challenging. And also, we realize that COVID does not care about any of us. And so please make sure that you are wearing your mask and that you are washing your hands, that you're also continuing to pour great foods in your body, that you're drinking water, that you're exercising, and that you're doing whatever you need to do to ensure that your immune system remains strong. If you need to talk to somebody, make sure that you reach out to a counselor to sit down and share what's going on with you mentally and emotionally during this season, because it is so important to us that you remain safe, that you remain healthy, that you remain mentally, emotionally, as well as spiritually strong during this season. That concludes my announcements. And at this time, we all shall prepare for the service of worship through giving. Let us prepare to hear our offering announcement. Give and it shall be given unto you. Good measure, pressed down and running over, shall the Lord give into your lap. We, the Village of Trinity, are committed to lifting up Christ, engaging our community, and celebrating our culture. Today, your gifts of tithes and offering will allow the work of Trinity to continue as we seek to provide ministry and resources to those who are incarcerated, ill, hungry, hurting, and whose backs are against the walls. There are multiple ways for you to support the Ministry of Trinity with your tithes and offerings. You may give through our Secure Give application. You may also text to give by dialing 855-781-8384. You can also use our Cash App, $TrinityUCC, or use our website. With a few easy clicks, you will be well on your way to support this ministry. Also, our First Fruits Direct Draft program allows you to make your church a priority. And if you prefer to mail your gift, simply send your tithe or donation to 400 West 95th Street. Thank you for supporting Trinity United Church of Christ, the greatest church this side of the Jordan.
Hey, family. Got a special announcement today. I will not be giving it, but a very special lady, none other than Sister Monica Moss, wants to give you an announcement of what we are doing this Advent season as we make way for the King.
I greet you with the love of Christ and with prayers that you and your family are managing your way through this COVID-19 pandemic. While Reverend Moss's sabbatical was in many ways refreshing and restful for the entire family, we couldn't help but be concerned for our church and our community, as our news feeds are constantly filled with the toll of this pandemic, and while we have been reminded of one of the major themes of this Advent season, that there was no room for Jesus when he was born. As we spent time in prayer, God pricked our hearts to consider what we might do as a church family to raise the spirits of our friends and neighbors. We decided that one thing that was needed was connection. We've all been quarantined and isolated from one another for so long, so it's absolutely time for us to connect again. Thus, during the season of Advent and these unique times, God revealed an amazing ministry opportunity for our congregation to make way for the King. As a reminder to our seniors, first responders, and families who are currently in homeless shelters, we will be asking you to join us in providing homemade Christmas cards as a reminder of Christ's love for them. We will be providing a lift and love like only Trinity can. The first step in this wonderful opportunity will be for you to register by December 16th, 2020. Once you register, we will communicate instructions via the Trinity UCC card kit, which will provide all the details, such as the card size, the date for drive-up delivery at the church, and much more. In addition, we will provide instructions for you and your family to create a video Christmas card that will be shared across all of our various social media platforms. The registration information is posted on the screen below. You can also find it in today's bulletin. We're inviting the entire Village of Trinity to join together as we all show our support and God's love for our extended community during this truly amazing holiday season. May God bless you all, and Merry Christmas.
Hallelujah. I'm here to encourage you this morning. Your ladder will be greater than your past. Oh, yeah. You will be blessed more than you can ask. In spite of what has been done, the best is yet to come. Your ladder will be greater. You gotta believe your ladder will be greater, 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 greater. Your ladder will be greater than your past. Your ladder will be greater than your past. And you look better than you do right now, right now, right now. You
You've been through so much. You've been through your tears.
Church, that is good news. Isn't that good news? That after all that has been done, after all that we've been through, whether it's through this pandemic or whatever you've experienced in life, that the best is yet to come. Your ladder will be greater. Somebody needs to hear that today, that your ladder will be greater. Your ladder will be, your future will be greater. And so why don't you give God praise wherever you are? Because you know today that your ladder will be greater. We'd like to thank Dr. Nunn for blessing us with that powerful music selection. Thank you so much, Dr. Nunn. God's people, we've come to that point in our service where we take the time to go to God in prayer. So wherever you are, we invite you to begin to silence and still yourself, center yourself for just a few moments as we go to God in prayer. Let us pray. Most gracious and loving God, we come into your presence right now. First of all, giving your name the glory, honor, and the praise. Why? Because God, you are so deserving of all the praise. You are awesome, God. You are amazing. You are altogether lovely. And so God, right now, we come just simply adoring you for who you are. And God, we also come right now asking that you would simply forgive us for anything that we've said or done that is unlike you. God, have mercy upon us, because God, we know we haven't been perfect. We've done some things that we ought not have done. We've said some things that we ought not have said. And so God, we ask that you would forgive us right now. And God, we just come also to say thank you. Thank you for blessing us over and over again. God, you've been so good to us. You've blessed us in so many ways. And so right now, God, we just want to say thank you. Thank you for waking us up this morning. Thank you for the food on our table. Thank you, oh God, for giving us a portion of our health and strength. Thank you, oh God, for keeping us in the midst of this pandemic. Thank you, God, for providing for us. Thank you, God. And God, if we had 10,000 tongues, we'd never be able to thank you enough. And so God, right now, we just say thank you. And God, right now, we come because, God, we need your touch. We need your help. Matter of fact, we are desperate for your touch. We are desperate for your presence. Someone's marriage is desperate for your touch. Someone is desperate for a breakthrough. Someone is desperate for your comfort. Someone is desperate for your direction. And so, God, right now, in the name of Jesus, we ask that you would meet your people at their point of need. God, we need you, and we realize that we cannot get along without you. So God, we ask that you would allow your Holy Spirit to fall fresh upon your people wherever they are right now. God, somebody needs you. So we ask that you touch. We ask that you would breathe upon your people. We ask that, God, that you would renew your people right now. For God, as we have sought to live and navigate this pandemic life, and the pandemic has sought to chip away at our life. And so God, right now, we ask that you would pour your spirit upon all flesh right now in the name of Jesus and restore your people. We ask, oh God, that you would grant them victories in their life. We ask that you would renew their hope. We ask, God, that you would show up right now in the name of Jesus and show out on their behalf. And God, we also ask today that you would continue to bless our nation. We also ask today that you would continue to bless those behind prison cell walls. We also ask today that you would bless and that you would comfort and that you would heal those who are sick in their homes and also in hospitals. God, we need your presence right now. We need a touch from you. We need your anointing on this day. And right now, God, we already declare and decree that you've already moved on behalf of your people. Matter of fact, we give your name the praise, the glory, honor right now. We say hallelujah for the victories that already are occurring. We thank God that we thank you, God, for allowing us to win. We thank you, God, for already bestowing upon us healing blessings. We thank you for the financial blessings that are flowing. We thank you, oh God, for the justice that is beginning to roll down like a mighty river. We give you praise. We give you honor. And we say hallelujah for what you're going to do, because God, we already know that you're up to something. And so God, right now, we thank you. We give you premature praise for all that you will do, for what you're going to do. We say thank you and amen. If you believe that God has already answered your prayers, you ought to lift your head to heaven and give God some praise right now.
When you've done all you can, seems like it's never enough. Tell me, what do you say when friends turn away, you're alone? Tell me, when you've given your all, seems like you can't make it through. Well, you just stand when there's nothing left to do. You just stand. Watch the Lord see you through. Yes, after you've done all you can, you just stand. Your past. Tell me, how do you deal with the shame? And how can you smile when your heart has been broken and pain? Anybody out there know pain? Tell me, when you've done all you can, seems like you can't make it through. Well, you just stand when there's nothing left to do. You must stand. Watch the Lord see you through. I tell you, after you've done all you can, you just stand. Be and be not entangled with that bondage again. You stand and endure. See, God has a purpose. Remember, God has a plan. Tell me, when you've done all you can, like you can't make it through. Child of God, just stand. You stand. You stand. Don't you dare give up. See, through the storm and through the rain, through all of your heartaches,
tonight. God promised joy, yes he did, with the morning light. So hold on and be strong. God's gonna bring you through, yes he will, and it won't be long. After you've done all you can, my God. After you've done all you can, after you've gone through the storm and the rain, after you've endured heartache and pain, after you've prayed and cried, oh, God's gonna dry your weeping eyes. After you've done all you can, God's gonna be there to give you a helping hand. Listen, after you've done all you can, you just stand. You just stand.
What a cool day in December, 1961. A group of creative and brave and prayerful souls came together to form what we now call Trinity United Church of Christ. Many of them have gone on to be with the Lord, but we are grateful to those who are still with us. We honor you. We thank God for you. We applaud your effort and your commitment. On behalf of this community, those who have been with this church for decades, and those who are brand new, we say thank you to every charter. We love you, and may God continue to hold you in God's loving, caring, and healing hands. Thank you once again, and may God bless you. As we approach the Word of God, let us pray together as a family right now. Lord God, we are grateful and we are thankful for this opportunity to approach your Word. Search us and search me specifically. And when you discover what does not belong in me, that blocks my ability to be able to connect with you, may you remove it. I ask, O God, that you would allow your Spirit to rest upon all who are witnessing this message. May you open their hearts. May you open their minds, that we may delve into your Word and receive revelation that you have placed for us for such a time as this. Let the words of my mouth, the meditation of my heart, be acceptable in thy sight. O Lord, you are my strength, and without a doubt, you are certainly my Redeemer. In the mighty and wonderful name of Jesus, we pray. And the people of God may say, Amen. I want to draw your attention to the gospel according to Matthew. Matthew chapter 24, beginning with verse 36 from the New Revised Standard Version. You may read along with me. The scripture is going to come up on the screen right now. Matthew chapter 24, beginning with verse 36, moving to verse 44. And it reads as follows from the New Revised Standard Version. But about that day and hour, no one knows, neither the angels of heaven nor the Son, but only the Father. For as the days of Noah were, so will be the coming of the Son of Man. For as in those days before the flood, they were eating and drinking, marrying and giving in marriage until the day Noah entered the ark. And they knew nothing until the flood came and swept them all away. So too will be the coming of the Son of Man. Then two will be in the field, one will be taken, and one will be left. Two women will be grinding meals together. One will be taken, and one will be left. Keep awake, therefore, for you do not know on what day your Lord is coming. But understand this, if the owner of the house had known in what part of the night the thief was coming, he would have stayed awake and would not have let his house be broken into. Therefore, you also must be ready, for the Son of Man is coming at an unexpected hour. Be ready, for the Son of Man is coming at an unexpected hour. I want for the time that we have together to focus on an Advent message. The next several messages over the next several weeks will be Advent messages as we are in the Advent season. I want us to focus on this idea of living between the notes. Living between the notes. I would ask you that you would flank me with your prayers on this day. The word genius should be used sparingly. It is often overused, and when it is, it loses significance and drops into the category of simply being above average when you use the word genius so much. Or worse, when the word then becomes simply mundane. I believe that there are those who are listening to me at this moment and this hour, especially those who are lovers of music, would agree with me that a person by the name of Thelonious Monk fits the bill of the definition of genius. It is Monk who stated, and I love how Monk puts this. It's Monk who stated that music is not made by the notes, but it's created in the rest, the space, and the silence between the notes. When you know how to handle the silence and learn how to live and create between the notes, this is where music is created. I want you to listen for a moment as Monk transforms this typical hymn that we have heard over and over again, written by Fanny Crosby, known as Blessed Assurance, into his own personal meditation about his musical journey and spiritual roots, all by knowing how to handle the silence and the rest. Let's listen to Monk for a moment. Now, I have to tell you, I do not know if Howard Thurman and Thelonious Monk met each other. I don't know if they knew each other or knew about each other. But there's something unique that Monk believed in the power of the navigation of silence. And Howard Thurman believed in an encounter with God comes through the quieting of the soul and the focus of the mind. It may seem strange to begin a message this day with this music, with the mystic and esoteric elements, but the essence of Advent is rooted in the navigation of silence and the hidden aspects of God. I want you to walk with me today. Let us walk together. We first have to establish what is Advent. Let me teach for a moment. Advent is the season of anticipation or waiting. It comes from the Latin word aventus, meaning coming or approach or arrival. It was in the early church, the 4th and 5th century, where they would have this grand celebration for new Christians. It was a grand celebration for baptism. And people would spend 40 days and nights in prayer and fasting, getting ready to take the final act of acceptance and to participate in the ritual that would seal them into the community of faith. And they believed the moment that a person comes up from the water and it seals their marriage with the community of Christ, that the Holy Spirit would show up and meet them when they come out the water. Later, Roman Christians connected the celebration to the birth of Christ using the word Advent, Adventist, Adventus, that we wait, anticipate, prepare, and celebrate. This is the season where we witness human history, where God shows up in human history. God comes in visible contact with us, not by angels, not by dreams, not by burning bushes, but God makes a decision to show up in the lives of humanity through a baby and a woman who carries the child named Mary, who is elevated, I say, to the highest known spiritual plateau. Think about it for a moment. Now, Moses had an encounter with God on sacred ground and witnessed a bush that was burning but would not be consumed. Elijah had an encounter with God, heard the soft, still voice of God after a storm. It was Isaiah who had an encounter with God when he witnessed God upon God's throne and saw angelic creatures and God's train, never God's face, and heard God's voice. But this moment of God breaking in rearranges our understanding spiritually. The fact a woman, or more appropriately, a young girl between the age of maybe 14 or 15, is given the deepest access to God and trusted with nurturing salvation in her room. Mary has more anointing than anyone in human history. Mary has more anointing than anyone who is chair of the deacon ministry, head of the trustee board, or the CEO of a corporation, or pastor of the church, or rabbi of the synagogue. God says the highest level and greatest expression of my anointed and holy touch will be upon Mary. This is truly revolutionary and shattering and should humble every preacher who dares to claim they're so anointed. You ain't anointed like Mary. We don't have the tenth of the anointing that Mary had. Another way to put it is this way, is that God trusted a young girl but did not trust grown men. This is the season This season is more than past celebration of Advent. No. It is not just a celebration of we remember Jesus was born on this day. Because all we do is that, we completely miss what this season is about. We've missed the mark. We've missed the chords and the rest that make up the divine composition we know as Advent that lead us to Christmas. We've got to find that God is working between the notes. There is a revolution here. There is a revelation also here, that God is working between the notes, between your revelation and your hallelujah, between your praise dance and your holy holler. Let me press this revelation I want to share with you. The Spirit desires us to upend our understanding of this season and our traditional practice during Christmas and what we call Advent. Let me press this. Let me press this for you today to see what is going on. We love to say, I'm celebrating Christmas. We love to talk about liturgically, it's Advent. But look at what happens in this moment. Let me help you out historically. Isaiah proclaimed, for unto us a child is born, 700 years prior to the birth of Jesus. Let me say it again. He says, for unto us a child is born, but the Jewish people had to wait 700 years to see the child born. The prophet proclaimed, but there was a space before the chord was even played. 700 years of anticipation, 700 years of waiting, 700 years between proclamation and manifestation. And during that 700-year period, there were multiple regimes, there were coups, there were invaders, there were colonizers. The Jewish people were trumped by Persians, barred by Greeks, and almost ruined by Caesars, who would not concede Jesus is Lord. And they became weary. Years after the announcement. And now we come to the moment that we celebrate around this time period where the announcement is made that Jesus Christ is born. But wait a minute. Then they had to wait another 30 years before his ministry began. Proclamation 700 years ago. Then when Jesus is born, they've got to wait another 30 years. Do you know how many people passed away and did not see the Messiah come to fruition? You see, most people get antsy after 7 minutes or 7 days, but a faithful people can hold on to a revelation even for 700 years, my Lord. And Matthew speaks the words of Jesus, telling us that Advent is not something that happened in the past, but that we are always in Advent right now and should have an Advent posture. I will break in. I will show up. I will show up in your life. You see, if you run into somebody that says that they know the hour and the moment and the day, the time that Jesus is going to show up, you know they're lying. The Son, according to Matthew, does not even know. Even Jesus cannot share this revelation because Jesus has not been given it. Matthew is saying right here, Jesus is communicating to us that you've got to be in an Advent posture all the time, just as the Jews were waiting for Jesus to be born. We must be in the posture of waiting for Christ to come again. Matthew's word is what is known as eschatology. Right there on the screen, you see the word eschatology. That means it's concerned with the final things of history. How things will work out for humanity. And this is the moment where Matthew is saying, no, don't expect God to show up on a date or at a time. Just be ready. Just as the Jewish people, when they heard Isaiah say, for unto us a child is born, they had to wait 700 years. And then when Jesus was born, they waited another 30 years and only got 3 years to see his ministry. And there's something here that I want to press to you that I believe that God has revealed. The scripture is calling us to nurture sacred awareness. Yes. Sacred awareness. I borrow from the great Harvard preacher, Peter Gomes. He says it this way, that we are not passive participants, simply waiting with no action, but the word tells us that we are to be ready. We are called to work, prepare, and be a witness. We must nurture a sacred awareness. Keep awake, the scripture says. Be aware, the scripture says. No one knows the time or the hour. Sacred awareness is a tuning of ourselves to catch God's beauty and holy mischief all around us. Yeah, yeah, that we can see God working in the peripheral vision of our spirits. Let me break it down this way. I recently was given the privilege by the Pixar Corporation to screen the film Soul. They sent us a link so that we could watch the film. The film Soul, some of you may have seen the advertisement. It's just a cartoon. But the message is so simple but also beautiful. It's a message about a gentleman by the name of Joe Gardner who wants to be a jazz musician. And he ends up disconnecting himself from his true purpose of what God had placed in him. Because he was so focused about being on stage, he didn't see all the blessings around him. And in the movie, the main message is simply this, that everyone has a particular purpose, but the real purpose that everyone must recognize is that in life, there are blessings all around you, and you have to learn how to look. The little things, the simple acts, are just as important as the big moments on stage. And when Joe Gardner realized this, every little thing became a blessing. Hearing the sounds of children playing, looking at the change of the seasons, being able to bring breath into his body, the gift of being able to play the piano, walking down the street, he started to find blessings everywhere. In other words, he had sacred awareness that there were blessings even in the midst of trauma. There are blessings around us. I have to be honest with you. That's why sabbatical became so very important to me. I was losing my sacred awareness. I was busy, but I was not productive. Burnout is not ordained or anointed by God. Sacred awareness allows you to find the little revelations all around you. And our ancestors were people who understood sacred awareness very well because they would use language that spoke of sacred awareness to say that my God is a mind regulator. My God is a heart fixer. My God is a burden bearer, a lawyer in the courtroom. What they were saying is simply this. The people who created these words were people who were disinherited and discounted by this nation. But yet, in the midst of having nothing, they could still say that our God is a lawyer in the courtroom, even though I'm not allowed to have a lawyer. that God is a burden bearer that can handle the burdens that I am bearing right now. I have a sacred awareness. And I say to you today that there's someone who hears the sound of my voice, that you need to cultivate your sacred awareness and witness all that is around you that is sacred, that is beautiful, that brings you joy, but also you are grateful for. Be ready. No one knows the time or the hour, which means you've got to cultivate your sacred awareness to be able to witness the small things that God is doing. Can somebody in the chat right now give a little shout about the small things God is doing right now in your life? The fact that you are able to breathe, the fact that you are able to move, the fact that you can be an advocate for someone else, sacred awareness. Be ready. We don't know the time or the hour. This Advent season is not something just in the past. We should always have an Advent posture. But not only this, that Matthew is saying that you've got to be ready. You need to have this sacred awareness, that Advent, this anticipation of when God is coming. We know not the time or the hour, but in the process, you have to develop the disciplines of the Spirit. You heard me many times mention Howard Thurman. He is without a doubt my favorite theologian. And Howard Thurman has a book entitled Disciplines of the Spirit. He said, if you want to grow spiritually, it's not about you going to church. If you want to grow and develop your spirit, it's not about how many times that you can repeat scripture. He said, there are five elements that if you want to have true sacred awareness, you've got to practice these disciplines. The first one, he says, is you've got to have some commitment. In other words, you've got to have commitment to God and your spiritual cultivation, whether the sun is shining or whether the rain is falling. He spends time, an entire chapter, talking about commitment is where spiritual growth happens. When you give yourself over to something, not a portion, but you give yourself completely. In the words of that theologian by the name of Paul Tillich, your ultimate concern, you give everything that you have. The commitment, when you choose to marry that which you cannot hold on to, that you create a covenant with God. The other aspect, commitment is one. The other is growth. He said, oh yeah, I've got to grow. No, he says it this way. Growth is a part of spirituality, but growth causes humility. Because a person who truly grows recognizes that they've stumbled into their growth. Because growth happens when we recognize how much I don't know, or when I fail, I'm also in the position to grow. So he says that you've got to be committed and you've got to be humbled by growth. And then he says something that many of us do not like. He says the other aspect is that there has to be some suffering. That in order for you to grow spiritually, in order for you to develop your sacred awareness, there has to be some discomfort in your spirit so that you will develop into the type of human being God desires you to. That growth is a part of how this world is structured. But suffering, as he says, pain is how we learn. Not that you want someone to inflict pain, but he shares that when a child touches something that the child is not supposed to touch and the child says, ouch, all of a sudden there is a memory that enters into the mind that is dangerous. When an athlete is working out, they realize they hit a wall that I have to push through that because my muscles then tear down and then build back up and I become stronger in the process. There are people who are able to find meaning in their pain and in their suffering, and in the process, they deepen their sacred awareness. And then it is Thurman who finally says that when you've got commitment and you have growth and you've gone through some suffering, then you then can develop a real prayer life. The first prayers that you develop are ones that someone gave to you. But the next prayers that you develop are the ones that come through you. That when you're committed and you grow and then you've had some suffering and some pain, all of a sudden your prayer life changes from God is great, God is good. All of a sudden you change the way that you pray and you offer prayers not about yourself, but prayers in order just to communicate, or as Thurman says, sometimes you just sit in silence. And finally, he says, the final priority is reconciliation. That you've got to reconcile yourself to understand that there's some brokenness in us in order to reconcile ourselves to God. And then we can reconcile ourselves with other people. Don't try to reconcile with other people and you haven't reconciled with yourself and you have yet to reconcile with God. The relationship horizontally can only develop when there is a proper vertical relationship and an inward relationship where we grow and reconcile the brokenness in us. So we develop a sacred awareness when we're in this Advent posture. And in this sacred awareness, we develop and nurture these spiritual practices. And that I must leave you today. This changes the priorities of how I live. Because now, because I've got sacred awareness, now because I practice my disciplines of the Spirit every day, I'm committed. I know that I'm growing, that I have been suffering, but I've developed a prayer life and I'm reconciling myself. Now I can live between the notes. I can be thankful even though I'm going through. I can shout even when God is silent. I can live between the notes before God plays the next note. When there's silence between revelation and revelation, when there is silence between seeing God break in and God break in again, when there's silence in those moments, in the commas of our life, when God pauses and takes a breath. And sometimes when God pauses and takes a breath, God takes a breath that seems like a second to God, but it may be several years for us. And maybe right now, you are just between notes. God is just pausing, taking a breath, and about to smile in your life. We learn to live between the notes. And when we learn to live between these notes, we can speak like Fanny Crosby, who wrote that beautiful hymn, Blessed Assurance. Did you know she was a blind poet and heard the melody in 1876? And the world changed for her when someone asked her, what do you hear when you hear this melody? She heard the notes. Even though she was blind, even though she was cast aside as a woman, she all of a sudden, when she just heard the melody, she said, Blessed Assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. Heir of salvation, purchase of God, born of his Spirit, washed in his blood. This is my story. This is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. Praising my Savior, regardless of what is around me, but I've been working on some stuff inside of me. Blessed assurance, praising my Savior all the day long. I live between the notes. I see God's fingerprints because I have sacred awareness. just as Thelonious Monk took his time playing those notes. Thelonious Monk is no longer with us. But I discovered a young man, probably about 18, from Korea, was playing and had been inspired by Thelonious Monk by the name of Johan Kim. I want you to hear Johan play with a little bit of Thelonious and a little bit of Bach at the same time and a tad bit of blues and gospel in between and hear God in between the notes. I hope that the music that Johan Kim played was a blessing to you. I hope that you will learn how to live between the notes. It is my prayer that this Christmas time will not just be a celebration of what God did, but that you'll be in an Advent posture, that we can make way for the King in everything that we do. May you find your sacred awareness. May you see the small, beautiful things around you. And may you develop those disciplines. May you be committed. May God allow you to grow. May you be blessed with enough pain that you will grow. May your prayer life change from the prayers you have been given to the prayers that come through you. And may you reconcile yourself with those things that are broken in you. May you also, on so many levels, also reconcile with God and reconcile with those in your family and those around you. And when you've completed all of this, it is my prayer that your spiritual life will change with all of the turmoil in this world. There is a convergence, spiritual movement happening across the globe. It's not on social media. It's not on television or what you stream. People are praying and leaning into the power and wisdom that flows from God and from our Savior across this globe. People are rising up and seeing it is love and it is just action that will change the way this world operates when we're connected to God. May your sacred awareness rise during this season. May God bless you. May God keep you. May God's Spirit guide you. And may God not make everything easy, but difficult enough that your muscles will grow, your mind will expand, and your soul will open up. God bless.
What a powerful word we just heard from our senior pastor. It was so good to hear him preach and teach on today. We ask God's blessings upon you, Pastor Moss, and that God would just continue to restore you. God's people, we've come to that point in our service where we take the time to offer Christ to those who might be in search of a church home. Trinity is an amazing village, and we would love to have you a part of our village. You should see an email and a phone number on the screen right now. If you are thinking about joining, you can email us right now or call us, and we will be in touch with you expeditiously so that we might get you connected to this branch of Zion. God's people, we thank you again for joining us for service, and we pray that God just will continue to bless you as you move through this new week with much peace. We've come to that point now where we take the time to close out with our benediction, and we say, may the Lord bless you and may the Lord keep you. Make God's face shine upon you and be gracious unto each of you until we meet again. Go in peace and have a wonderful week.
Lord.